And welcome once again to EWTN's Bookmark. Our guest author, Jesse Romero, the author of The Devil in the City of Angels, My Encounters with the Diabolical, published by TAN, available through the EWTN Religious Catalog. Jesse, it is great to see you in person again.
Thank you, my friend.
You've been associated with EWTN over the many, many years. Life on the Rock in the very early days, right?
Back I was the very first guest.
1997, that would have been?
Correct,
would
Jeff Cavins.
Yeah, February of 97, I think it was when we launched the
memory.
Show. I was here.
Okay.
I worked on the show.
Got it.
And you're not a person anybody forgets. Now, you've done a lot. You've been in radio, done a lot of things, men conferences, etc. Now, people always think of you as kind of a guy like a Doug Barry out there pitching to the men, etc.
We're good friends,
like
by
that.
The way. Yeah.
And you guys are good friends. The Devil in the City of the Angels. My Encounters with the Diabolical. Why isn't it Devil in the City of the Angels? Like they always say L.A. is the City of the Angels. Why City of Angels?
City of Angels, it's obviously that's what Los Angeles means. I lived there most of my life, 54 years. I've been 4 years over in Phoenix, Arizona. And I just wrote a book describing a lot of encounters that I've had, some of it as a cop and some of it just as a lay Catholic evangelist, with the occult, with the diabolical, with the preternatural. Mm-hmm. And I'll tell you why this is important, because especially the Hispanic neighborhoods, this has been systematically put in place, I would say, by the devil.
Really? Why in the Hispanic neighborhoods?
I believe that the devil hates Mexico specifically because of the apparition of Our Lady of Guadalupe in 1531.
I see.
And I believe that Mexico specifically targeted because of that. The only physical evidence of a Marian apparition. Mm-hmm. And so you'll find right now in Mexico is at the throes right now of a huge diabolical disorientation. You got Santa Muerte, mm-hmm. which is the religion of the cartels, which is being exported to the Southwest, to all the Hispanic enclaves out here in the United States. Mm-hmm. You got Santeria. That's been around for decades. It's being exported also from South America through Mexico all the way over here. Brujeria, witchcraft, huge in the Hispanic community. Satanism is huge in the Hispanic community. Most people don't realize that the center of Satanism in the Americas is Veracruz. Catemoc, Veracruz.
Really?
They have an annual gathering of Satanists. It's a conference where they're taught how to do mad black magic, animal sacrifice, hexes, curses, incantations, and people from all over the Americas go there to get trained, and they come back.
How long has that been going on? Is that something reasonably new that has been happening, or is this something that's been happening for a long time?
No, it's recently. I think it's probably been going on for about the last 10 or 15
years.
Now,
you mentioned in the book a little bit, and not to blame the church per se, but you do mention to some degree that your perception of us downplaying after Vatican II some of the, let's say, mystical aspects or the supernatural aspects of the faith allowed people or found people who were looking for that dynamic in their spirituality to go look someplace else. Is that right?
Absolutely. Right. Catholics are gravitated to the mystical, to the supernatural. And I grew up in Southern California. I was a teenager in the 70s, middle school and teenager in the 70s.
You were a good-looking guy, according to this book, I can tell you that.
and I can tell you that my formation, a lot of our formation, it was just balloons, banners, and butterflies. Mm-hmm. It was cookie-cutter Catholicism.
You too, huh?
Yeah. And so as a result...
String paintings.
As a result of that, I've heard about the devil, but mm-hmm. he's more like kind of a mythopoetic creature, mythical, medieval superstition. And it wasn't until I was a rookie cop that I said, wait a minute, this stuff is absolutely real, what the church has been teaching for 2,000 years. Work in the county jail, 21 mm-hmm. years old. I worked a section of the county jail. We had the worst killers in the Southwest. Some of them were fighting their cases. Some of them were already convicted. It was called the Mentally Ill Offenders Unit. And I told my watch commander, sir, I'm going to be here for 6 weeks. I'm on rotation all over the jail. I'm a rookie cop trying to learn the ins and outs of the jail system. I said, where can I learn about these guys? You say these guys are the worst of the worst. They need a three-man escort everywhere. He says, you can read about them. And that file, police reports, psych evals, probation reports, if you want to know about these guys. I sat down there. I was just 6 weeks on rotation, and I'm a high-paid babysitter. Every 15 minutes, you do a suicide watch. So I'm reading about all these guys, and I can tell you, Doug, over 50% of these guys that were locked up there, over 50% on their probation reports, psych evals, psychiatric evaluations, they're saying, I killed because I was told to by the devil, a demon, by Satan, a voice. And so I'm saying, I'm 21, I'm saying, I thought this stuff was like a fantasy. Right. Not to these guys. These guys believe it's absolutely
real.
Well,
the mental health people would say, well, if he's hearing voices and he thinks it's the devil, it's because he's mentally ill, not because there's really a devil telling him.
Right. That's what the mental health people would believe. So, I mean, so I had this cognitive dissonance as a young rookie cop and as a Catholic. I'm saying, okay, science says this is just a mental illness, but then there's another side of me. These guys are, if you hear what they're saying, no, I'm doing this. I'm a Satanist. I'm part of a coven. I was told to. I hear voices. I have a relationship with he's my father. I'm saying, they're saying something different. Well, what does the church say? Well, the church has been talking about this for 2,000 years, not real loud, but yeah, it is part of church teaching.
Right. It's interesting, too, because in a sense, the church will always say the first thing you do is you check the natural. Make sure that it's not mental illness before you jump to the conclusion that there's something else going on. But you said you actually had experiences even with Ramirez, the Night Stalker, right?
I had long conversations with him, and I can tell you this. I remember one day hearing at Holy Mass, 1 Corinthians 12:3, second reading, nobody can say Jesus is Lord except by the power of the Holy Spirit. 200 guys locked up, solitary confinement. They're all serial killers, mass murderers, sociopaths, psychopaths. Over 50% of them said that they killed for Satan. So I said, cell number 3, cell number 7, cell number 3. I'm going to ask these guys, I heard yesterday at Mass, this verse in the Bible. I'm going to just ask them. So I asked the Satanist in cell number 3. I'm there with another officer. I said, hey, by the way, I'm just wondering, I'll go get you, because they fed the officers very well in the jail, officer dining room. I told them, I'll go get you whatever you want, order up, and I'll sneak it down here to your cell. All you got to say, what do I have to do, officer? You'll do that for me? Absolutely. Just say, Jesus is Lord. Doug, I told 3 different guys that were there that were serial killers and said they killed for Satan, if they could say Jesus is Lord, and I would bring them whatever they want from the officer's dining room, I would sneak it in. They tried to. They said, you'll do that for me? That's all I got to do? Yeah, that's all you got to do. As they tried to say Jesus is Lord, all of a sudden, it's like they started getting sick. They could not say those words. It's like if there was glue in their mouth, there's cement, they're holding their throat, and they're turning different shades of red. Their knees are buckling, and I'm physically seeing that they're getting ill trying to say Jesus is Lord. The other cops that are with me, the other rookies, are saying, Romero, cut that out. This is creepy. This is freaking me out, man. Quit doing that. And I remember I felt like just an ice cube go down my spinal cord, and I said,
yeah, you say that in the book, right?
Wow, this is what the church says is true.
Because you actually saw when he was trying to say it, wasn't it Ramirez in the case? He actually changed,
they
right?
Physically could not say that.
Right.
And their face started turning different shades,
right.
dark gray, different shades of red. They're choking.
Get a guttural sound.
And they wanted
right?
to say it. They're trying, right. but they physically couldn't right. say it. Right. And I remember at that moment, that was at 21 years old, I said, this is true what the church has been teaching.
Now, the forward says, today we're witnessing an unprecedented rise in the occult all over the world, even inside the church. The evidence is overwhelming. And this is the auxiliary bishop, right, in Phoenix, who wrote this and said, many people have had encounters with evil spirits and the diabolical. But because we have become more secular and less faithful, we're led to believe that demonic possession or simply an awareness of the devil is just a type of mental illness that can be cured. So is there more out there and we just don't recognize it?
I'm going to say there's more out there. I'll tell you why. I was talking to this one very popular exorcist. He says there's a rise in Satanism because of 3 reasons, Jess. He said, number 1, less people are being baptized in the church. Number 2, less people are going to Mass on Sunday. He says, number 3, less people are getting married in the church. He says there's less sacramental power flowing throughout the world, and it flows through the church. He says, that's why you'll see that it takes an exorcist a lot more, many more sessions, sometimes months and years. He says, because the prayers of the, quote unquote, the church militant are weaker. There's less people living in a state of grace, because our prayers in the body of Christ, they help the church. They help our priests and the exorcists. But where there's less Catholics receiving the Eucharist or living in mortal sin, not being married throughout in the church or not baptizing their children, it makes the church universal's prayers weaker.
I thought one of the great images that the Bishop Eduardo put in here, he talked about Our Lady impact and these kinds of things. And you show in the book how powerful she is in these kinds of things. Even what I'm saying, get her off me, I think one of the people was saying. But he said, we serve Mary, a 12-star general. That's a great image.
Absolutely. I love... That's a Revelation chapter 12, right. verse 5 image. marry the 12-star general. And when you look at the tradition of the church, you'll have some of the great saints giving her those military terms. Mm-hmm. St. Louis de Montfort, and many other Mariologists, they call Mary with using military language.
Mm-hmm. Now, you referred to in the very beginning about why you wrote the book, you talked about the idea of ecclesiastical malpractice. What did you mean by that?
Well, Doug, I don't know if you remember that one of the Jesuits in the church, and it's, you could print out the article, I think about a year and a half ago, he denied the fact that there is the devil. He said, "No, we don't think this is true." So we have people in our own church, prelates in our own church, that would just assign the devil or the diabolical or demons to something like medieval superstition. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of Catholics, especially in the Hispanic communities where they have botanicas, these are little occult satanic shops to try to recruit and infect Catholics with this with the diabolical. Mm-hmm. And so this is a very real experience for Hispanic Catholics.
So with something like that, it struck me, you tell a story, I think, that had where you went to one of those, and I think one of them had to do with a love potion, things like that. So in some ways, are they brought in by these things that seemingly are harmless kinds of things, and then they're brought deeper into the occult that way?
Many of us are broken because we're sinners, we feel this emptiness. We're drawn to the mystical. We know there's something else beyond this world. And so a lot of Catholics are attracted, especially in the Hispanic communities, to these botanicas because that's what they do promise, the esoteric, the preternatural, the mystical.
And power.
And power, especially
right.
power.
Right.
And if you do this, that, and the other, this protocol and stuff, you could have that guy fall in love with you. You could make this much money. And so there's always a seeking of power, this curiosity.
You can get your sports career back on track.
Yeah, there's another story.
That story that's in there.
And
right?
So this is why a lot of, this is what I call low-hanging fruit Catholic, mm-hmm. are attracted to these botanicas, these occult shops.
Well, one of the things you pointed out, you said in a recent study reveals that Catholics are among the least likely to agree that Satan is a living being. You say 55% of evangelical Christians see him that way, but only 17% of Catholics polled indicated that.
That's embarrassing. Mm-hmm. Can you imagine? We're the one true church started by Jesus Christ, the Son of God, and this is part of the preternatural, angels and demons. This isn't a doctrine of the church. This is a dogma of the church. A dogma is higher. That means it's revealed by God. It's revealed by heaven. Mm-hmm. And when you only have one out of five Catholics that actually believe in the preternatural, angels and demons, that's a problem.
Right.
That's a catechetical crisis.
Right. Well, you quote C.S. Lewis in the Screwtape Letters and relate it to where we're dealing with today, where Screwtape tells his young protege, Wormwood, that the most effective thing he can do to bring souls to hell is to convince people that Satan does not even exist.
He's done
and,
a good job.
And that survey shows that they're winning that.
He's done a good job. And I'll tell you, this is, but yet, I think the secular media has capitalized on this because a lot of Catholics and a lot of Americans in general, you know where they get their information from? The preternatural? Watch the 12 to 15 TV series that are on. Haunted House, Haunted Mansion, sci-fi series, paranormal activities, et cetera, ghost hunters. This is where Catholics are getting their information from, and it's not Catholic.
Right. And what's strange is, the same people would show some disbelief about the revealed truth of the scripture having to do with angels and demons, but are very interested in ghosts or easily believe in ghosts.
Exactly. It goes to show you and stuff. They're searching. They're searching
right.
for the truth.
Right. There's something missing.
Absolutely.
There's a truth there that's being denied. You say, what about those people, perhaps most Catholics, in fact, that do believe in the existence of the devil, but still choose to live a faith that which is lukewarm, tepid, or indifferent?
If we as Catholics would just listen to our very prayers, the St. Michael the Archangel prayer given to us by Pope Leo XIII, which talks about the reality of the devil. The Our Father talks about the reality of the devil. Mm-hmm. Deliver us from evil. If you look at the catechism, it tells you, it says the correct rendering is deliver us from the evil one. Even Pope Benedict, in a homily that he gave, he says the rendering at the end of the Our Father is really a reference to Satan or the devil.
Mm-hmm.
So this is part of the deposit of faith.
It's interesting, though, today you would say, even though our present Holy Father brings up the reality of the devil, but there seems to be this kind of undercurrent of, even if that's true, the reality is, through God's mercy, everybody's going to get saved.
Surprise, surprise. That's what I believe the devil wants everybody to believe. The fact is, every time Jesus Christ talks about salvation or damnation, every time, I mean, go to a red-letter Bible, Jesus will say, many are called, few are chosen. He'll say, strive to enter by the narrow gate, for many people walk the wide path of destruction. Every single time our Lord talks about the finality of things, he always says that by the words of Jesus, more people are walking towards damnation.
You say, while pride offends God the most, it is lust that sends the most souls to hell. Beware of the sins of lust. This admonition, too, came from Our Lady of Fatima in Portugal in 1917.
And we're seeing it right now. What are we dealing with since the sexual revolution? Every single Catholic family has been affected. Every man's been affected. Every woman's been affected by the sexual revolution. Contraception, abortion, cohabitation, etc. And if you think that it only affects the lay people, now we've discovered as of 2002, mm-hmm. it's been affecting the clergy for decades.
Right.
Everybody's wrestling with the sixth and ninth commandment. It's the easiest sin to fall into because we have a human body, and if your conscience is not formed with the Word of God, you end up trying to follow your passions, and your passions are fleeting.
What does it mean to be the term perfect possession?
Perfect possession is a term that Malachi Martin and some exorcists have used, which means a person, for example, somebody like Hitler, they would say that he was perfectly possessed. You look at him, he could carry on a conversation. You know, his eyes aren't black or rolling back. He's not shaking, not convulsing, not growling, not baring his teeth. You know, you could have a dinner with him. He could, you know, he can go play golf with you and wash the car. He looks absolutely normal. He can jog. Perfect possession is the person who's aligned their will with the diabolical, and so they can function and operate perfectly.
And they actually totally invited them in.
Completely.
Right.
Their will
not
is
even
a,
by a mistake. Like
no.
Somebody who might have,
no.
Like
this
a
is
Ouija
by this,
board
no.
and said, and then had a...
Right. That's involuntary.
Right.
Okay? And there's oftentimes, or that's done as a result of just curiosity. Mm. Perfect possession, for example, you have Father Fortea says that Hitler was perfectly possessed. Mm. Father Gabriel Amorth says that Joseph Stalin was perfectly possessed. These are people that completely align their will with that of the diabolical. And when you look at them, they look just as normal as you and I.
Now, you have a story in here. It was a Saturday night family disturbance called Second Encounter, where you a gentleman was being held down, and then you went to go into that place and held and asked him to let him go. And you said he was simply levitating in the air for a few seconds before the men pushed him down again.
So I remember this like
so
yesterday.
So you saw that.
Yep. This is probably in the early 90s, working a two-man car, East Los Angeles, PM shift, 4 to midnight. Get a call towards the end of the shift, family party, loud noise, music, drinking, family fight. We get there. We run up to the second story. There's an old Hispanic lady. I was probably in my early 30s back then, so that's why she's like my age now. She's talking to me in Spanish, officer, come in here, my grandson, he's attacking everybody, he's destroying the whole house, help us, what do we do? I get in there, I see like five guys, 30s, 40s, 50s, probably his uncles, his father, they're holding down a young boy, he's on the floor, and they're holding his appendages, they're holding his arm, and you can see he's fighting, he's like a wild dog. And I'm saying, what happened, ma'am? I said, our grandson, he's just started attacking everybody today and stuff, and he's not in his right mind. He goes through these fits of anger, and he just starts attacking and breaking everything. I said, what else can you tell me? She goes, oh, we found this under his bed. And she showed me a Ouija board. She goes, it's La Ouija. She goes, he's been doing this. We've been telling him not to do, but he still does it. I said, oh, I put it aside. My partner, who was kind of a fallen away Catholic, he was saying, Jesse, what do we do? What do we do? I said, pray! Mm-hmm. Pray! They didn't train us to do this. Dude, pray! Mm-hmm. I ran around those guys. They're holding them. I said, start praying the Our Father. Mm-hmm. Everybody in Spanish. Padre nuestro. Start praying the Hail Mary. Start praying. I told lady, bring me holy water. Bring me sacramentals. Bring me a rosary. And man, at this point, I'm just thinking, this is not normal human reaction. I talked to the parents. They said, he's not a drug addict. He's playing the Ouija board. My mom and dad have told me about this, you know, in the Spanish community. They said, this will attract a demon. This guy's spiritually afflicted. I stood with five men in uniform on a Saturday night, my radio going off, beep, beep, beep. My partner in the corner, I said, pray, pray. And I started praying in Spanish, the rosary. And I'm praying it like with a baritone voice. I'm saying, pray it loud, pray like you mean it. I said, let him go, let him go. He stopped kicking, he stopped struggling, he stopped scratching, and he stopped cussing. And we let him go, and the kid stood there, and I'm like, okay, I'm expecting to fall on the floor. I went like this, I dropped to a push-up position because I'm going like this. The kid was off the ground. We all completely let him go. And at that moment, I said, continue praying. Then we pushed him down slowly to the ground. We continued praying. We probably prayed nonstop for 30 to 40 minutes. And all of a sudden, it's like the kid snapped out of a dream. He started crying. And he told his grandma, Abuelita, grandma, grandma, thank you, thank you. They're gone. They left. They left. I started talking to him. I said, what were they? What happened? He goes, officer. He goes, there's these things that live inside of me. And they left. These things that you were praying and putting on me, they left. Mm-hmm. I told them, tomorrow morning, you need to get him signed up for confirmation. There's a Catholic church down the street. I know the priest. Tell him Deputy Romero was here last night. Tell him what happened. Mm-hmm. Sign him up for confirmation. He needs to get to confession. And I'll take this Ouija board. I'm going to destroy it. I took the Ouija board, me and my partner,
burned it. Right. And he said, the monster is gone, right? Yeah. That was the expression he used. Now, you mentioned that demons are very legalistic. How so?
Demons know when they have permission to attack somebody. What invites a demon? Mortal sin. Living in mortal sin, living a life of evil and debauchery, is a green light for the diabolical. They're attracted to evil people that live in mortal sin. So they know what removes their ability to attack you and even to attach themselves to you. What removes that? When you live in a state of grace. Mm-hmm. When they know that you're in a right relationship with God and free from mortal sin and fighting even against the proclivities of venial sin, when you're in a state of grace, they have to leave because they can't live in a person who's praying and receiving the sacraments. They'll go to somebody else who's in mortal sin, mm-hmm. who's dirty and unclean like they are.
Mm-hmm. Now, you mentioned a person by the name of Lola. Who was she?
Lola. Let me see, which story is that one?
That's where she told me she knew the Catholic faith was the true religion from God because she was told this, ironically enough, by her satanic elders. And talked about the fact that the Catholic Church, they believe it's obviously the church founded by Jesus, which is why they attack it and why also Satanists are compelled to steal the Holy Eucharist. And you were involved with stopping somebody from doing it, a witch or something, right?
Right, in one of the stories. Every single person that I've talked to, Lola being one of them, that was in East LA as well. That was another call that I handled. And every single one of them has told me that they know that Jesus Christ started the Catholic Church. It's the one true church. And they all say that Jesus Christ is truly present in the Eucharist in every tabernacle. And they're all mandated to steal the sacred host. That's part of being in a satanic coven, to steal the satanic hosts and take them to their covens to commit sacrilege and blasphemy upon the host.
You also mentioned the fact that in one particular episode with Lola about her strength, etc., when she had experience, and that would help was the Hail Mary in Latin.
Okay, I know specifically now that. I'll make it quick. Lola had been consecrated to the devil in Mexico by her father, who later committed suicide. Her mom came to the United States, and the mom embraced the Catholic faith and brought her daughter into the Catholic faith. But as a result of all the baggage, because she had been ritually consecrated as a child, she was still dealing with a lot of ritual consecration. And so what ended up happening is two priests were assigned the case in this one particular undisclosed diocese, and these two undisclosed priests mm-hmm. that were assigned to the case, they had asked me if I would come and be part of the team. Mm-hmm. And what you do as a team member, you're at the priest. First of all, you got to be in a state of grace. You got to be recently confessed. You hold the holy water. You hold the book. Mm-hmm. You hold whatever they want. Do this, do that. And then you hold the person down. They instruct you, hold them, let her go. Hold them, let them go. And you're praying the whole time. Right. Your mouth is shut, and all you're doing is praying under your breath, Hail Mary, full of grace. Right. And this one particular case, I could tell you this. I witnessed these two holy priests pray over her 30 minutes, 60 minutes, 90 minutes, 2 hours, 2.5 hours, 3 hours. Mm-hmm. All I can tell you is they prayed every prayer available to them in their arsenal. Mm-hmm. Nothing was working. She was as wild as a dog, ferocious. Her body got bigger.
She, yeah, you describe it in the book, right?
She went from like 120 pounds to like 200 pounds. Every part of her body was felt like...
You said like a puffer like a, fish,
like,
right?
Yeah, like a puffer fish, exactly.
Right, right.
Like a Louisville sluggerback. Everything was hard. Mm-hmm. And she was a small, little, frail woman when she... At the end, this one priest said... They're looking at each other like exasperated. They're going over and over again.
Right, trying to.
And then they said, let's pray the Hail Mary. That's the only prayer they hadn't prayed. And then the other priest said, who knows it in Latin? If you know it in Latin, let's pray it in Latin. I knew it in Latin, so I started praying the psalm. Mm-hmm. They prayed it loud. Ave Maria, gratia plena, Dominus tecum. Unbelievable what I saw. Mm-hmm. The woman started screaming as if she'd been stuck with a hot poker stick, mm-hmm. screaming in these awful, garbled voices, screaming and saying, get her off me! Get her off me! Right. Sounded like Smeagol in Lord of the Rings.
Right.
She went on her stomach, extended her arms in a cruciform on her stomach and screaming. I'm looking. She's there with four brothers are there. Four brothers are holding her down, too. Her mom was there. Mm-hmm. Two priests were there. Her body is being smashed like a tortilla, like a pancake. It's being smashed. I'm seeing her body being smashed, and it's getting longer. I'm going like this and still, Ave Maria, gracia plena. And she's saying, get her off me, get her off me. One of the priests says, in Jesus' name, I order you to tell me who's on you. And she said, the lady, the lady, get her off me. My wife and my mom and her mom were praying in front of the Blessed Sacrament. And I remember my wife said, she's here. Don't you see her? My wife looks up. She's here. I didn't see nothing. I'll be honest with you. And all of a sudden, she convulsed for about 30 seconds. The priest says, let her go. Let her go. Keep on praying. She stopped convulsing. The mom went up to her. The two priests went up to her. They turned her around. They sat her up. They put her on the pew. And she looked at the priest. She hugged him around the neck. Father, thank you. Mom, thank you. She was crying. She goes, they're gone. They're gone. Thank you. The other priest asked her. He's taking notes down. The other priest says, why did they leave? Why did they leave? She said, they didn't like that last prayer.
Right.
They didn't like it. They had to leave.
That's interesting.
I'm telling you, Doug, these eyes, I saw 3 hours of two holy priests praying, everything at their disposal, and what drove this demon out was the Hail Mary.
And that's just a sample of the many stories people find in this book. I like the one image you have about the fact that people are worried about climate change. They should be worried about the real climate change and where they're going to spend eternity. Thank you so much, Jesse Romero. It's
Thank you, great to have you here.
You need to have a little more energy, you know?
I'll work on it.
Jesse Romero, The Devil in the City of Angels, My Encounters with the Diabolical, powerful, published by TAN, available through the EWTN Religious Catalog, EWTNRC.com. Join us next time right here on Bookmark. Thank you.